Swayam Prabha, Digital India, Educated India.
So for that, I have to thank Vijay Gaikwad, an intern who came this summer from VJTI Mumbai and helped me prepare the content for this particular presentation, in which we will discuss longitudinal stability and neutral point, two important concepts that you will need. So basically, let's see what is the reaction of an aircraft when it is disturbed. So the aircraft is in trimmed condition, forces are in balance, moments are in balance, and now some disturbance acts on that particular aircraft. So its reaction determines its stability. So the aircraft is considered to be stable when, after disturbing it, it comes back to its initial position without any action of the pilot. If the pilot has to bring it to the condition, it's called as control. But stability means without pilot input, on its own. So therefore, if it does not return to the initial position, then the aircraft can be considered to be unstable. But there is also one step in between called as neutral. So stability is of two types. There is static instability, in which the aircraft departs from the equilibrium. So it just departs. And you also have dynamic instability, in which case not only does it depart, it also becomes more and more unstable. Okay. So the tendency initially is static and the final outcome is dynamic. Okay. Let's have a look. So in short, if you look at static stability, the first step, it is only a function of the initial reaction, the tendency, not the final outcome, but the initial reaction. As you disturb an aircraft, what is its initial reaction on its own? That determines static stability. So definition is, when you disturb an aircraft from a trimmed position or equilibrium position, if the aircraft tends to return, it need not return finally, but at least the tendency is to return, then we call it as a statically stable aircraft. Okay. So there are three basic types. One can have positive static stability, which is illustrated by this kind of a behavior. So you have an aircraft on the extreme left, it is disturbed, because of which it is pitching up slightly. So the tendency is it is coming down. Okay, that is the initial tendency. So this is the positive static stability. Then you have neutral static stability, in which case there will be no attempt to either become undisturbed. So neither will it come back to the position nor will it go away. If it is disturbed, it remains disturbed and remains disturbed. This is called as a neutral static stability. It will still stable because it is not going away. Okay, but it is neutral. The third one is, of course, negative static stability. In this case, you will notice that if you disturb it, it goes to a position of disturbance, but then on its own it goes further away, then we call it as a negatively static stability. But then why the word stability? Because we don't know what will be in the end. Okay, right. So let's look at these three steps in some other way. Okay, first is neutral stability. So we have a ball on a flat table. We push it to a position, it goes to that position and remains there. you push it towards the left and leave it, it remains there. This is neutral. Okay. Now let us look at positive. So this is an example of positive stability. You have original state when the ball is at rest at the center. You take it to the right and leave it. It doesn't go further ahead. It comes back, but it may exceed the position where it was, go to the left and then come back and then go and then come back. What eventually happens is a function of dynamic stability. But the ball is statically stable because it does not go away, further away. Okay. And this is negative stability. So you place the ball and now you disturb it slightly, it will keep on going further and further away, either on this side or on the that side. This is unstable. Okay. So these are simple examples. But we are concerned about flight, not about balls on rotating surfaces. So this is a equilibrium flight. The aircraft is at some angle of attack, though not shown, but it is level. So no, thrust is equal to drag, lift is equal to weight if it is a level flight, and no net movement. You could incline it to make it a climbing flight study, again it will be in equilibrium. Moments are still in balance, although lift is not equal to weight. Lift is in fact less than weight, incline. Now this is neutral. You fly an aircraft, you disturb it, it remains disturbed. And this one is unstable. Okay. So I'll give you an example, a small video clip which shows the behavior of an unstable aircraft. This is a remotely controlled aircraft. It takes off, goes into nose up, some disturbance comes, gone. If this aircraft was statically stable, then when this pitch up, when the pitch down moment came because of the disturbance, it would not have just gone down. Let's see once again. Observe the motion of the aircraft. So a takeoff is fine, it lifts off, some disturbance we cannot see, there is some disturbance, but after that no way of recovery on its own. So if the pilot of this aircraft was highly skilled and very quick in reacting, he or she could have avoided a crash. When the aircraft is pitching down, you could have quickly put the elevator and made it pitch up. So you can control an aircraft which is statically unstable. This is what the Wright brothers did when they were flying the first aircraft, Wright Flyer. It was inherently unstable, but they were making it stable, or they were making it fly by very skillful flight controls. Okay, but you can't expect that from every pilot, and therefore we want to make the aircraft sufficiently stable. If you make it too stable, then the pilot has to really work very hard to do any control. That's also not desirable. Okay, so we need stability, but we need adequate amount of stability. We don't need the plane to be too stable, and obviously we don't want the plane to be unstable. So both extremes are bad. So much about static stability. I'll just sum up once again. Static stability is basically only the intention or the initial tendency of the aircraft to respond to disturbance on its own. If the initial response of the aircraft is such that it tends to come back to the undisturbed position, it is statically stable. If the response is that it doesn't either come back or go away, it's neutral. If the response is it wants to go further away, it is unstable statically. Now let's come to dynamically. So whereas in static stability the intention or the initial tendency is the only consideration, in dynamic stability we want finally the aircraft to come back actually to the original position on its own. So not just intention, not just tendency, but actually coming back. So the final outcome of disturbing an aircraft depends on its dynamic stability. The initial response depends on static stability. So let's see. So an aircraft is going to be positive in dynamic stability if the oscillations after disturbance reduce in amplitude with time. Okay. So, and the extent by which they reduce is the extent of dynamic stability. If the oscillations damp out very fast, it is highly dynamically stable. If the oscillations do not damp out, okay, then it is neutrally stable. If the oscillations increase, it is unstable. If the oscillations damp but slowly, it is less dynamically stable. Okay. So, you can see in this case, you have an aircraft going in level flight, there is a nose down pitching moment. So, it tends to come up, that means it is statically stable, but it overshoots again down, again up, again down, finally it comes to the original position after a period of time. Hence, it is having positive dynamic stability. In neutral, once again, the oscillations are same in the magnitude, in the amplitude. So, you disturb the aircraft, it oscillates, but it does not either come down or go up, it remains. This is neutrally stable. It is stable because it is not unstable. That is why we say stable. And obviously, unstable or negative stability is when the oscillations are going to worsen, increase further with time. Now, how do you control this aircraft? Only by pilot intervention. You can still fly this aircraft, but you will need constant and regular pilot intervention. In today's modern aircraft, you might be able to control the aircraft by automatic flight control, which senses the position of the aircraft, senses the moments acting on it, and deflects the control surfaces automatically. Okay. So, you can do that. So, a quick summary is basically given by this small video. You can actually make out by looking.
Will actually nose down even further, so that a static stability, dynamic stability is the overall tendency for the aircraft to get back to its initial flight path. A dynamically stable aircraft will eventually return to the flight path after a few oscillations. A dynamically neutral aircraft will carry on oscillating like some horrendous roller coaster. A dynamically unstable aircraft will carry on oscillating but with increasingly large oscillations, which will probably...
Okay, so this is a quick summary. Remember, this video on YouTube is actually 7 minutes long. So, what you have seen is only a small clip. It is a very detailed video which talks about stability, static, dynamic, longitudinal, lateral, all stabilities, and it gives, it is a very, very detailed video. I will request you to watch it as a self study, but our concern right now is only this. Now, obviously, when you are going to take part in the competition, you would like to have a stable aircraft because you do not have any control on it. It is a glider and you are not remotely flying it, nor you are sitting in the aircraft to fly it. Once you throw it, okay, whether you use a rubber band to throw or whether you use hand to throw, that is up to you. I have not mentioned, but I am allowing you to do anything. But when you launch it, it is gone. After that, its behavior will depend only on its stability characteristics. So, therefore, you cannot, and some people might have got an idea, let us make the aircraft neutrally stable dynamically, so that when we throw, it will go up and down, up and down, up and down, it will spend more time in the air, we might win the endurance flight. Okay, this, some people have tried this, but try it out at your own risk, because if that does not happen, the plane will simply crash and you will get neither long distance nor long endurance. Okay. So, it will be safer for you and a good idea for you to make the aircraft adequately stable, not too much stable. Now, if you want to have a flight of maximum range, Actually, the aircraft has three kinds of stability. Stability in pitch, stability in roll, stability in yaw. So, obviously, you want aircraft to be stable in all of them. But our syllabus does not cover the other two types of stabilities. I'll just give you a very brief idea. If you perfectly balance the aircraft, if both the wings are equal weight, or when you hold the aircraft, it doesn't have a tendency of imbalance, it may not roll. Okay, it may not do this. Remember, if the aircraft rolls, it will not fly straight, because we have seen in the last lecture, rolling and yawing are coupled. So, if your plane starts rolling and you don't have any control, it will definitely yaw. If your plane starts yawing, it will also roll slightly. So, you have to design your plane so that it doesn't roll, it doesn't yaw, only then you can throw on a straight line and hit the pillar, because any deviation is going to be subtracted. So, what you have to do is, from the point of view of yaw stability, the only thing you can do is when you throw, you ensure that it flies straight. It doesn't have any inbuilt imbalance. So, the vertical tail should be perfectly centered to the center, if you use one vertical tail. If you use two of them, then they should be equidistant and they should be perfectly aligned. That's all you can do, and of course, the lateral balance. But if you want the aircraft not to roll, you have to bring in some roll stability, and that I leave it to you, how to figure out, how to make it stable in roll. But I will teach you today how to make your aircraft stable in longitudinal motion, so that when you throw, it doesn't go up and then down, or it doesn't go down, it flies fairly straight. Okay? Obviously, tell me one thing, how will you get maximum range? For a given amount of throwing capacity. What is the condition that you will try to implement? Right, you have to throw it at an angle, or you have to make the aircraft act with the wings fixed at an angle, so that when you throw horizontally, the angle of attack of the aircraft is corresponding to maximum L by D. How do you know that? You might get the angle for maximum CL by CD for an aerofoil from the data, but how about the aircraft? So, it is not easy. Okay? But at least you should be sure that your aircraft flies fairly straight. So, let us see how you make to do it. The whole game is basically about these three centers. Okay? There are three centers in aircraft design, and these three centers have to be located with respect to each other in a specific relative position. Okay. So, the first one is center of gravity. The center of gravity, obviously, you know, is the place where the moments on the aircraft are acting, because its weight act on it. So, normally we take the moments about center of gravity. One reason is that the heaviest item of the aircraft is the aircraft weight. So, if you balance, you can do about any point actually, it is not a problem. But normally as a convention, we always balance moment about center of gravity. So, there is one point. Now, these three locations you do not worry right now, we will very soon see the relative location. So, this depends only on mass distribution. So, this can be controlled by you, by adding mass, deleting mass, you can control the CG position. It does not depend upon the aerodynamics, although the shape of the wing will affect its CG slightly. Similarly, how long is your fuselage, how large is the tail, all that will affect the center of gravity, what material do you use, but fairly controllable with you. The next one is the center of pressure. The center of pressure is the point where the resulting aerodynamic forces are applied. These forces are the forces of lift and drag, and it depends on the model's aerodynamics and on the angle of attack. So, now this is interesting. The location of the center of pressure, or the place where the net lift is acting, or the reaction of the wing is acting, That particular point will depend upon two things: at what angle you are flying and what are the forces acting on it. Now, controlling the angle of attack at which you fly is very difficult, and even if you throw it by some kind of a launcher, you know, 1 degree, 2 degree, 3 degree makes a big difference. So, it will be necessary and interesting for us if we can somehow remove the dependency on the angle of attack. Would it not be nice if the aerodynamic forces and moments could become independent of the angle of attack? So, one variable gone. Okay. So, let us see what it is. The third important point is called as, so let us see now the center of pressure. Center of pressure, you know, it is going to change. So, it depends, as I said, on the aerodynamic force, it changes with the angle of attack. So, the center of pressure is the average location of the pressure, it varies around the object, and numerically if you want, you have to take the integral of the elemental force acting on elemental pressure acting on specific on small areas into the distance from the nose or a relative point upon the sigma of the pressure. Okay. But this is not of much use to us because it changes with the angle of attack. Okay. Then we have a neutral point, the third point. This is a reference point for which the pitching moment does not depend on the angle of attack. Right. Then this depends only on the aircraft geometry, not on the aerodynamics, not on the center of gravity, but only on the external geometry. Again, this is a point which is very difficult to determine. It is difficult to do calculations and say I calculate and hence NP is here. Okay. So, the location of center of pressure or aerodynamic forces is not in your control. It depends upon angle of attack, depends on what speed you throw and the aerodynamic coefficients of your aircraft. So, you might copy an aerofoil very accurately, but how do you do the calculations for the fuselage, for the tail, etc., it's not easy. Interestingly, individual values are not important, the relative location is important. Okay. So, the neutral point is another good definition of that would be, it is that place, if the CG comes to neutral point, the aircraft becomes neutrally stable. So, obviously, if it goes behind, it will be unstable, which you do not want. But are you okay with a neutrally stable plane? Are you okay? No. No, because a slight discomfort or a slight miscalculation will make it unstable. So, it is better to be in the stable domain, but do not make it too stable, because then it will not be recovering. Okay. So, there is a very good book by an author called Andy Lennon on the basics of remotely controlled model aircraft design. We have a copy of this book in our departmental library. It is also available in the institute library, and soft copies are available online. So, I recommend for those of you who are serious about designing your plane, it is a very good book to give you basic ideas. It also contains some sample designs which are good, well flying glider designs. So, you can actually borrow from there, you can copy from there.